Well, good morning, everyone. It is great to see each and every one of you. And if you're a visitor, I want to invite you to fill out that visitor card that will be on the pew back in front of you. And I would love to get to know you and let you know what we at Beulah Baptist are all about. And just fill that out. We won't hound you with useless calls or texts. We just want to invite you back and let you know what we believe. And by way of announcements, for those that don't know Miss Sarah Smith, she's a missionary who, through her ministry overseas, we support a family. And next Sunday we'll have our mission Sunday, and we'll be getting an update from Miss Sarah Smith. So please come and hear what the Lord is doing overseas through our support. At this moment, I would like to just ask you if you could bow in prayer with me as we open up this hour to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for what you've done in our lives, God. We thank you for who you are. Lord, we just thank you that we are able to gather here freely, Lord. God, I pray that each and every one of us that gather here this morning, that sit in these pews, Lord, that we're hungry for your word. Lord, I pray that we're not the same when we leave here as when we were when we walked in. God, and I also just want to thank you. Thank you for just the role of a father that you have instituted and for calling men to fill that role. Lord, we submit this hour to you. We ask that you soften our hearts, open our ears to respond to the truth of your word. It's in this we pray in your son's name. Amen. But I do want to say Happy Father's Day. I have many adopted fathers sitting in this room before me, and you guys have all played a part in my life, believe it or not, for a year now. And I just want to say thank you. You guys have really made Logan and I feel welcomed and at home and part of the Beulah family. So thank you to the fathers here this morning. If you will stand with me for opening hymn, we will be in hymn 139, At the Cross.
Sinners.
Thank you. You may be seated. If at this time you will open up your bulletin, on the front inside page you will see our responsive reading. We are making our way through the book of Psalms, and this morning we are in Psalm 8, 1 through 4. I will read the bold if you can respond with the following. O Lord, our Lord, how magnificent is your name. Throughout the earth you have covered the heavens with your majesty. When I observe your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you set in place.
What is a human being that you remember him? A son of man that you look after him?
Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, as we have read your word in unity, God, we thank you that we can observe your heavens, that we can observe the work of your fingers, that we can look at the moon and the stars and recognize that you have set it into place. God, as Boogie pointed out in Sunday school, this world is perfectly habitable because you have made it that way. And we thank you for that. We thank you that, as we just read, even as sinful humans, Lord, you look after us. Lord, thank you for being a God that draws near to his creation. Lift this up in your son's name. Amen. Will you stand once more for our offertory hymn? We'll be in hymn 514, When We All Get to Heaven.
Jesus, sing it.
Heavenly Father, as we just sung, what it will be like when we get to heaven, we thank you for the sacrifice that allows us to enter that glorious place to begin with. God, as we go into our time of offering, Lord, I pray that we recognize what you've done in our life, what you've given us, and that we're not selfish with it, but that we give expectantly and eagerly, and that we trust you to use our giving for the furtherance of your message. Lift this up in your Son's name. Amen. Amen. What a wonderful, beautiful truth that is to proclaim. We will be true unto death. I want to share with you an incident that occurred this past Memorial Day. It was a day of joyous fellowship, and those who saw competitive, spirited games. Braden, Isaiah, James, and I, we were engrossed in not just one game of cornhole, but probably about 5 hours of game after game after game. And little did we know. Is that better? All right. I have my little birdies that tell me if it's good or not. Little did we know or could have ever imagined what was about to happen. It was after a few hours of playing, we went in, got some food, got some water, and we were aiming to resume cornhole. We were strolling through the backyard, just walking. It was probably Isaiah, Braden, and me at this point. We were just walking back to the cornhole boards, and then in our serene walk, we just hear a, and we just look at each other. And then we look off into the distance to see the sound that pierced the air as it hit the ground that stopped us in our tracks. And we were greeted with this sight of, it felt like 20 feet, but it probably wasn't that long. But a massive black snake had fallen from above, crashing to the ground. And then James walks up, and Isaiah is poking this thing, holding it in place, and I'm terrified. But in that moment, a new fear gripped my life, a fear of trees. You see, growing up, my parents had a hammock. And not one of those solid ones that you take out to the beach. It was one of those rope ones that had the holes in it that you always got stuck in trying to get out. But in that moment, I could only imagine being back in that hammock and then a snake falling and landing on me and me squirming and getting stuck and the snake just, yeah, it was a bad time. I was filled with a mix of fear and disgust. So your pastor, and all my masculinity and my bravery, we yelled back to the porch. And eventually, like a guardian angel, Kim's husband, Brian, fearlessly approached this snake and just reached down and he lifted it up with this confidence I've never seen. And he just slammed it down on a log and brought out his knife and just swiftly brought that snake's deceptive reign to an end. Now, why do I share that with you? You see, all these years later, snakes are still out to get us.
No.
Yeah. It's illegal to kill snakes in Virginia?
Yeah.
We won't post this video. Think back to the book of Genesis when we witness the serpent's temptation of Eve, right? Leading to the tragic introduction of sin and death into this world. And today we'll be in Luke 4, 1 through 13, and we find ourselves witnessing the devil, that loathsome, deceitful serpent attempting to ensnare Jesus. But unlike Eve, Jesus emerges triumphant, defying the wiles and the temptations of the adversary. So Beulah, while on that day, your pastor was very emasculated in a way I hope to never be again, it did teach me a truth of this passage this morning that kept popping back up into my mind as I was reading and studying this passage. And it made the passage resonate with me all the more because it just reminded me of the ongoing battles we face. Hal and Brian, I know you're not Jesus Christ in the second coming, but I got this picture of going all the way back to Genesis 3 and comparing it with the story of Luke of how God promises the serpent that your head will be striped. And I just pictured Brian picking that thing up and slamming it on the log. But we can take heart today. The serpent that represents the enemy, he continues his relentless pursuit to tempt us, to entangle us. But we can take heart in Jesus because we have a victorious Savior who has conquered every temptation. His triumph over the serpent's schemes is our hope of salvation. And as we dive into Luke 4 this morning, I want us to keep in mind these struggles that we encounter daily, these enticements, these deceptions, these temptations, and the dangers that are out there in the world that seek to undermine our faith. and how we can find courage, how we can find strength as we witness in this passage Jesus facing the serpent's temptations and emerging triumphantly. So, through him, through Jesus, we discover a power to overcome, the wisdom to discern, and the grace to resist the temptations. So, let us embark on this journey of Jesus in the wilderness. And I pray that this exploration of this text, I pray that it ignites this renewed determination to resist temptation, to cling to the truth of God's word, and to find strength in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. All that to say, if you're willing and able, would you please stand for the reading of God's word? Will you pray with me to pray our hearts for the hearing of God's word? Heavenly Father, with your word open before us, as we stand in unity, God, I pray that your word does a work in us, that Beulah Baptist can be known as a church that resists the temptations of the world, that lives in unity over your truth, that does not quarrel like the world, that's not deceitful like the world, but that emulates you. So that when we leave these doors, we can say, as Paul did, imitate me as I imitate Christ. It's in this we pray in your Son's name. Amen. Luke 4, 1 through 13. Then Jesus left the Jordan, full of the Holy Spirit, and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days to be tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and when they were over, he was hungry. The devil said to him, If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. But Jesus answered him, It is written, Man must not live on bread alone. So he took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. The devil said to him, I will give you their splendor and all this authority because it has been given over to me, and I can give it to anyone I want. If you, then, will worship me, all will be yours. And Jesus answered him, It is written, Worship the Lord your God and serve him only. So he took him to Jerusalem, had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, He will give his angels orders concerning you to protect you. And they will support you with their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus answered him, It is said, Do not test the Lord your God. After the devil had finished every temptation, he departed from him for a time. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of God remains forever. You may be seated. We're going to jump right in to our first point. I titled it The Stake of the Wilderness. It'll be in verses 1 through 2. So read once more Luke 4, 1 through 2 with me. Then Jesus left the Jordan full of the Holy Spirit and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days to be tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and when they were over, he was hungry. In these verses of Luke 4, we encounter this profound truth unfolding before us. Picture it in your minds. Jesus, just baptized, right? Right before the genealogy came the baptism. He's filled with the Holy Spirit. He's led into the wilderness, that desolate, that treacherous place. And I want us to understand that this was no wanderlust of Jesus. This was no accident that Jesus ended up in the wilderness. It was an intentional journey led by the Spirit of God into the face of temptation, into the wilderness. And that wilderness, the testing ground of trial, isn't it? Jesus, our Savior, entered the ring of the wilderness with all of its harsh terrain. For 40 days, And 40 nights he fasted. He communed with his Father. And he faced the very depths of temptation. Now, can you fathom the weight of this moment? At this moment, it might be easy to say we can, as we just had a great breakfast this morning. But Jesus hadn't eaten for 40 days and 40 nights. I'm part of a pastor group that meets every week, and just from pastors in the community, and I ask all of them, what's the longest you went fasting? No one beat a week. Our Savior went 40 days and 40 nights without eating in the wilderness. The sinless Son of God stepping into that testing area, bearing the weight of our salvation upon his shoulders. And I say that because I want us to understand the severity of these tests. They must not be underestimated, because if Jesus in his humanity had yielded, had given in to any of these temptations of the evil one, of the devil, our hope of salvation would have crumbled as though it was a house built on a shifting sand. Our salvation rests on the fact that Jesus was sinless. If he had given in to any of these temptations, he would not have been sinless. He would not have been able to save us. But we don't have to fear, because when he died, he was the sinless, perfect lamb, because he emerged triumphantly from that wilderness. His obedience, his faithfulness, I believe it reverberates through the ages, securing our salvation today, all these years later. Now, with that in mind, I want us to ponder the significance of that wilderness. So I want us to gaze upon the testing ground, because that's what it is here. Because Jesus is battling the prince of darkness in this wilderness. And I want us to be reminded that in our own battles with temptation, we too can find strength in our Lord, just as Jesus did. Because you see, Jesus has paved the way, demonstrating that salvation is at hand and that we need not be slaves to sin anymore. And I pray that our hearts are stirred by the weightiness of that truth as we stand in awe of the sinless Lamb who conquered the wilderness. Now, as we journey through the rest of the passage, the first two verses just sets up the scene for what's going to happen in the following verses. I pray that the Spirit guides us, that the Spirit convicts us to transform us into the image of Christ all the more through these words of God. And I pray that we're not just hearers of the word, but doers of this truth. Now, turn your attention to Luke 4, 3 through 4. I promptly titled it The First Temptation. Read verses 3 through 4 with me. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." But Jesus answered him, "It is written, man must not live on bread alone." As Jesus stood in the wilderness, Satan approached him with cunning words, questioning his identity. And we see the crux of what's going on here. If you are the Son of God. The devil sought to bring into question the sonship of Jesus Christ, to undermine Jesus' confidence, dare I say, in his divine nature. And how often does the enemy employ the same tactic with us, whispering doubts into our hearts and our minds, causing us to question our identity as children of God? But Jesus, as wonderful as he is, undeterred by the crafty schemes of the devil, responded with resolute strength, declaring, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God." In this response, Jesus, he picks up the sword of God's word, refusing to succumb to Satan's deceit. And he reminded Satan, and he reminds us today, that true life does not depend solely on physical sustenance. That true life is found in the nourishment of God's Word. Now, this first temptation, it carries implications for us. It echoes the temptations faced by our first parents, Adam and Eve, all the way back in the Garden of Eden. Just as the serpent enticed them to doubt God's goodness and doubt God's Word and seek fulfillment apart from God, the devil sought to lead Jesus astray in the same way, from his complete reliance on God the Father. But Jesus, unlike Adam and Eve, he stood firm, unwavered in his obedience, and unwavered in his commitment to fulfill the will of the Father. So what does this mean for us? I believe it serves as a reminder of the importance of anchoring ourselves down in God's Word, relying on God's truth, and wielding it as a weapon against the enemy's lies. And just as Jesus demonstrated his trust in God's Word, we too must saturate our hearts, saturate our minds with Scripture, because it is the nourishment that sustains our spiritual life. And I pray that we're inspired by the example of our Savior, Jesus Christ, in the wilderness, who resisted temptation, who resisted it by anchoring himself in the Word of God. And I pray that we follow in his footsteps, trusting in the promises of God and recognizing that our true life comes from feasting on God's Word. Now, as we navigate the trials and temptations of life, may we stand strong, declaring, just as Jesus did, man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Now, read verses 5 through 8 with me to see the second temptation. So he took him up and showed him the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. The devil said to him, I will give you their splendor and all this authority because it has been given over to me, and I can give it to anyone I want. If you, then, will worship me, all will be yours. And Jesus answered him, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Now this moment, it shows us once more the enemy's schemes and underscores the importance of our devotion to God. Because as the devil took Jesus to a high place, as he took him up, as Scripture says, he showed him all the kingdoms of the world in an instant. That's a pretty audacious attempt to entice our Savior. The tempter declared, to you I will give all the authority, all the glory, as your Scriptures may say, because it has been delivered to me, and I will give it to whom I will. All you have to do is worship me. So, at this moment, so far, the devil has tried to tempt Jesus by getting him to rely on him for life and trying to get him to worship him. The deceitful nature of the enemy's offer is very evident. He seeks to attract us with the allure of power and authority and worldliness. But Jesus, with unyielding allegiance to his heavenly Father, responded firmly once more by saying, it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and only serve him. You see, this second temptation, it has an important lesson for us, because it underscores this truth that true worship is reserved for the Lord alone. It reminds us that the kingdoms of this world may temporarily be under sway of the evil one, as he boldly proclaims in this passage, but the ultimate authority and the ultimate glory belongs to God alone. You see, though the devil may assert his power for a time, there will be a time where it will be taken back. As we read in Philippians 2, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. There will be a moment in time where every nation will bow before God. You see, though the devil may assert his power, it is ultimately powerless. And he is going to try to do everything he can to make you think otherwise. Now, in a world that offers us often. Temptation of power and influence and worldly acclaim. We're called to remain devoted to worshiping God. We're reminded that our worship must be reserved for the one who deserves it. Now, if you think in your lives, where's most of your time spent? One pastor said, if you show me your planner, I'll show you your idol. Now, true it is, but how often do we neglect our time of worshiping God with things that do not deserve our worship or time? This temptation, at least it did me, it compelled me to examine my own life, my own heart, my own calendar, and discern the areas where I am easily enticed by the enemy's offer. So I ask you to do the same. Are there areas in your life where you compromise? Where you compromise on your worship of who God is? Where you pursue worldly gain, worldly recognition? So I pray that we can be vigilant, that we can be resolute in following the example of Jesus, who rejected the devil's deceptive offer. You see, this second temptation, it serves as a reminder of the urgency to worship and the urgency to serve the Lord with undivided hearts. So may we resist the deceptiveness that the devil puts forth before us. And may we join hands in unity to worship God alone. Read verses 9 through 12 with me now to see the third temptation. So he took him to Jerusalem, had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, 'He will give his angels orders concerning you to protect you, and they will support you with their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.'" And Jesus answered him, "It is said, 'Do not test the Lord your God.'" This moment, it illustrates to us, and it shows us, and it brings forth the light that the enemy's cunning tactics, they're nothing new. The devil, in a desperate attempt, took Jesus to the pinnacle of the temple in Jerusalem. And from there, he urged him to throw himself down, quoting scripture to support his proposal. "If you are the Son of God," the devil proclaimed, "throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command the angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against the stone.'" Don't we see the craftiness of the devil here? In our text, we only see three temptations. There may be more. Remember, this went on for 40 days. Maybe a temptation lasted multiple days. We're not made aware. But we do see the craftiness of the devil as he seeks to manipulate even the Holy Scriptures to deceive the Son of God. Now, for just a moment, I want you to truly think about what just happened. The devil tried, in his manipulation, tried to use the Word of God against the Son of God. Do you see how ironic that truly is? The devil tried to twist the Word of God to the incarnate Word of God. The Word of God is walking in flesh and blood. The Word of God is made incarnate in the life of Jesus. And the devil is trying to twist the Word of God to the Word of God. Think about that. Jesus responded differently this time. He said, "It is said, 'You should not put the Lord your God to the test.'" You see, this underscores this importance of rightly understanding and rightly applying the Word of God. The devil twisted the Scriptures to suit his evil agenda, attempting to provoke Jesus into a very reckless act. But our Savior, in his response, exemplified the proper reverence, the proper submission, the proper understanding of God's Word. And this temptation reminds us of the dangers of testing God's faithfulness. Jesus recognized that it was not his place to force God's hand or to put God to the test. He demonstrated complete trust in who his Father was. Refusing to manipulate, refusing to demand miraculous signs, he trusted his Father. And as we contemplate this temptation, I challenge us to examine our own lives. Are there areas in our lives where we are tempted to put God to the test? Where we are tempted to demand what we ought not to demand of God to validate our faith? Are we twisting God's word to fit our own desires, to fit our own agenda, to fit our own narrative? Because it's exactly what the devil was doing in this passage. And who are we to think that if the word of God was twisted to deceive the word of God, who are we to think it won't be done to us? So I pray that this moment in the wilderness that serves as a solemn reminder to approach the scriptures with humility, seeking God's truth rather than distorting it for our own purpose. You see, this third temptation, it's a challenge to us. It's a challenge that we make sure we handle the word of God correctly. Scripture says if we do not, if we twist it, we will have to give an account for that. So I pray that we trust in God's faithfulness and that we refrain from twisting his word. I pray that we approach his word with a heart of submission, with a heart that is desperate to live aligned with the word of God rather than manipulating it. Now, as we navigate the treacherous terrain of temptation that Jesus has been in for 40 days, I pray that we follow the example of our Savior. He held fast. He held tightly. He clung to the truth of God's word. And he refused to manipulate and test his Father. So let us commit to the same, to walking in the fear of the Lord, to honor his word, and to trust him. Our last point, we see victory in the wilderness in verse 13. Read that with me. After the devil had finished every temptation, he departed from him for a time. In this verse, we find this truth that convicts me. This victory achieved by our Savior in the wilderness, after going through the relentless temptations of the devil, having ended every temptation, departed from Jesus. And this is what kind of put this verse into perspective, this whole passage into perspective, those words, but only for a time. The enemy retreated, not solely out of defeat, he was defeated, but with a lurking intent, waiting for another opportune time. This verse reminds us of this ongoing nature of temptation. It reminds us that even after this victorious encounter that Jesus just had, the enemy will not relent in his pursuit to lead us astray, because he knows his time will come. He bides his time, though, seeking any opening, any vulnerability to launch his attack. And I pray that we as Beulah are not naive to this. I pray we're not deceived into thinking that we are immune to temptation or that our spiritual battles have ended. The enemy is cunning. The enemy is patient. The enemy is persistent. He waits for the opportune moment when we may be weary, when we may be complacent or vulnerable, or even when we as a church are growing. We see that happen in Scripture. We see churches that are growing, but then they're attacked from within. You see, we don't know the moment he will attack us or tempt us. We don't even know the means that he will use to attack us and split us. But we do know this, that the attack is inevitable. So what does this mean for us? It means that we must be ever vigilant, constantly on guard against the schemes of the devil. We must be prepared. We must be armed with the Word of God and dependent on the Spirit's leading. Because we are not left defenseless. Like, we're not. Our Savior, Jesus Christ, who emerged victorious from the wilderness, showed us the way to overcome these temptations. He demonstrated the power of God's Word. He demonstrated the power of relying on the Holy Spirit. He demonstrated the power of obedience to the Father. And we too, as a church, corporately and individually, can walk in those footsteps, can find strength, and can find guidance in how He overcame these temptations. And I pray that we individually and corporately as a church are people who resist the devil. That we are people who are steadfast in our faith. That we are people who are unyielding in our commitment to the Word of God. I pray that we're diligent in cultivating a strong faith with God. I pray that we immerse ourselves in God's Word. As we talked about in Sunday school, that we have a life of prayer. Prayer that shows dependence on God, not prayer that's solely just about ourselves. I pray that we're not caught off guard, because if we are, it can divide a church. Now, as we navigate this text, remember our strength does not come from our own self. Not once did Jesus rely on His own strength. What did He do? He relied on the Word of God. He said, "It is written." And how can we rely on the Word of God if we don't know the Word of God? If we don't correctly know the Word of God? You see, in the Word of God, we find wisdom. Now, wisdom will help us overcome and discern these temptations. But I pray that we are ever watchful, because the enemy awaits an opportune time. Now, we're going to enter into a time of response, a time of invitation. And if you're a believer, let us respond with gratitude and a renewed commitment to who God is and what He has done in our lives. Because this morning we have witnessed Jesus' triumph over temptation. And let this inspire you all the more to overcome temptation. Now, if you are an unbeliever here this morning, if you have yet to repent and believe, sadly, as of right now, that victory isn't offered to you. But if you repent of your sins and believe in the One who died and raised for them, He will help you. He will give you that victory. He will give you eternal life. So I challenge all of us here this morning, believer and unbeliever, throw yourself at the Word of God. Because it is where we see His love, His grace. We see characteristics about God. We see where we fall short. And even in the midst of us falling short, we see God sending Jesus as that bridge. Meditate on that. Respond to it. Don't just let it go in one ear and out the other. Don't leave this room the same as when you walked in. We will be in hymn 309. Lord, I'm coming home. I will be down front if you have any questions, any prayer requests, but please do respond to the Word of God. Hymn 309. You may be seated. Lord, I'm coming home. What a glorious time that will be. When we are not weighed down by the burden of sin and the antics of politics, antics of the flesh, we will be glorified with God and praising God for all of eternity. I can't wait. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, as we end this time, Lord, I pray that we don't neglect your word when we leave this building, but that we rely on it all the days of our lives, that you help us, Lord, and that your spirit guides us just as it did your son, that your spirit guides us to rightly discern your word, to convict us if we do not discern it correctly, and to also convict us to not keep it to ourselves, but to share the truth of your word, Lord. Lord, your word brings life, and there is a dying world out there. Pray that we can be the hands and feet that you use to share the message of your truth that brings life. So this we pray in your son's name. Amen. Will you stand?
We are one.